So actually here in Seattle, I didn't have a seen a commercial gallery since 1986. So he might have showed him wall and
I believe that's what she said she's seen in the media.
As I have showed the King Kong in art gallery space and the incorporated it to complete myself, but I didn't have a big show like this in a night space.
Well, this looks real nice for you. You've done something that a lot of people don't do. You filled the space.
Really?
It's a big space.
Well,
it's a big
space. You know, long ago when I used to have shows, this number of paintings was a minimum people had. But I really am very glad that half of the work is new.
Yeah. Great. Yes, this is Seattle Pacific University's art department. We are the off-campus building. Everything else is up that way, a couple of blocks. But this was a building that was, it wasn't dairy in the sense of in Macau, but this is where milk was brought and made its business. The back room, which sort of was room we use for sculpture, was the loading dock at one time. It had no back wall. And then doing it, they put walls in, so we've filled this space up.
And a museum that you created was the operation.
Yeah, this is as a faculty person here, I wish I knew.
Beautiful. I love her paintings. Her use of colors. Just beautiful.
Good.
The very first one inside the door. We all fell in love with your very, very first one.
Very tall, 12 and 14 tall panel, and they were scenes of Seattle, and I have to give you stickers on the windows.
They make a glitter.
Yeah. And then that club was Himali, the whole building, a friend of mine came, and you know what, I saw your candles that came in from the floor, and I buy them. That was John Bessel. And I thought, wow, what are you going to do with
me? That was a big one.
We took it.
How are you? Oh, I feel well. I am so pleased about it.
Lovely.
Thank you.
Is that an old one? No, that's a new one.
I am very fond of it, and we have gotten already rejected from at least 4 shows.
Really? But it's
really so hard to get into this popular color show.
You know, the other day I was talking to my students. We're doing a design project which has to do with color and value and learning about changing intensities, changing the hue, and changing the value. And so I brought them out here and showed them how you had taken and moved from the dark down to the light, and how you also had not used your color right out of the tube and you changed the intensity.
I should not use the color out of the tube. You know how many colors are in that black?
Yeah, I know.
Sometimes I get into trouble because I don't quite remember which colors I got that black from. And then to get it back is quite a struggle.
It is difficult, but that's training the eye. And I try to get them to look, to train their eye to see value and to see the intensity changes. Sometimes it's easy to pick it right out of the tube, but when they have to mix it to gain effects such as depth, or as they move, you're moving to get your eye to move to the center through light. In fact, I showed them this is exactly what a value scale is, and this is what they did, is they worked a value scale in black, whites, and grays, and then had to work it into color and see if they could match their black, white, and gray value scale and do it in color as well. Also, I showed them the difference between your warm and your cool relationships in here, and they're very subtle. They're very close in value and close intensity, but the hue change is so subtle, so you get something that looks dark, but it really isn't dark. It is dark, but there's such a wonderful change of hue in there. From the warm to the cool, and how you've overlaid one on top of the other with that crumpling.
It's awfully, awfully nice to have somebody really understand what I am doing.
Well,
it's lovely.
It's a part of painting, isn't it? It's so simple just to take it right out of the tube and put colors you like. But, which is all right, that's emotional, but if you're trying to do some things to give illusions, then you don't always put just the colors you like. You manipulate the color.
Well, frankly, Louise, when I was a first year student, that's what I did. And as a matter of fact, Mr. Isaac said, why don't you in general to the students, you should black out of the tube. And I just never could bring myself to that.
Using just black.
No.
There's nothing wrong with it, but it gives a different illusion. I also tried to show them. Let's go over this painting because I tried to show them how you do some compositional things, especially in this painting, and the other one around the room. I tried to show them how you use your symmetry in terms, and if they had to reduce this down to a simple geometric composition, how you used your light here and here to give you a symmetrical look, and then of course centered it in the center, and then how you were consistent with this painting, and we moved it over to this painting. Let's go look at that one and see that symmetry. Use your light in the middle, and you use the symmetrical framework that you have, and I pointed that up.
So I am very fond of these symmetrical compositions, and sometimes I think, my goodness, can't I ever do anything else? And in this painting, I experiment at this diagonal in the middle of the painting. And as you can see, I discarded them.
You mean moving from here down to... Oh, right in here, yes.
I did, but our love has changed completely, and it ended up being a completely supernatural change.
Can't help myself, can't.
Well, the patient tells what you want to do.
Yes, right. I sometimes tell my students, let your artwork speak to you.
Oh, you if can. They don't speak to you, might as well give up.
That's right. And they always are trying to force it. I said, okay, analyze, let us speak to you, what's happening here? And then the two of you have a dialogue going back and forth until it comes off the way you want it, and the painting has some interaction too. I sometimes they tell them their mind's eye is what they want, but sometimes they can't bring their mind's eye down here, and you've got to let this picture pass back and forth again.
Well, when you are very young, you have got to learn logic. You know, one of the things on this term is learn art is no longer, but to this very day, in my studio, I hear him say, develop it.
Yes, right.
He
said yes, that all the time, yes.
And to this very day, develop it. Very, very important. It means that you shouldn't give up. And even when you think that your painting is all done, don't put it away. Look.
Right. Or
look.
Step back to it a little time later and then re-evaluate.
Take it out, and sometimes you have very unpleasant surprises, but sometimes you have very nice surprises.
And then it feels just right when you can say it's complete. Of course, as we said the other day, Bonnard didn't think his paintings were ever complete. He always took his paintbrush out.
To the Louvre. Right. And changed them a little bit.
Right. Uh-huh.
You know, Larry, I must say that I am very fortunate that I have met you, and I am very fortunate that you decided to let me have an exhibition in this beautiful gallery, and I am even more fortunate to have a person with your knowledge and understanding in front of this exhibition.
Well, you know, when I was a youngster in university, I heard of your name a lot.
You did?
Well, that was 1957. And of course your things were at the Seattle Art Museum, and they were showing in different galleries, and I think I even saw some things on Mercer Island, where some of your things in the Mercer Island Fair over there, when they used to have that fair all the time. So I've always been very familiar with your work.
No, I didn't know that. I wish I had known that.
Your work is always so very calm and so very quiet, which is quite beautiful. A lot of people coming from your background might show an awful lot of anger in their paintings, but you have just reversed it, and you're showing solitude, you're showing quiet, which is wonderful.
You know, Larry, I often think of that, and of the fact that whenever I tried, when I was younger, things also, the very cataclysmic experiences which made it possible for me to be here and to become a painter, to begin with, I always failed. And finally I realized that I really paint from much deeper than those experiences. I paint from the depth of the person who was made ugly by my family and by my parents mainly, and which made me the person who could survive and could stay sane to begin with. And there comes the sanity from, it comes from my desire for beauty in my life. And life is very complicated and not very easy to carry on, but you can always look at nature and art, and the serenity comes out of that, because otherwise I am a very tortured person.
Well, I understand that. You know, even in nature there's a lot of violence, but out of violence comes the serene part of nature, and out of, so in a way, we are a part of nature. We have violence within us, but you are bringing out the serenity. You're not capitalizing on just that violence.
I can. So it's not really my choice.
Well, you've gone through the storm, and now the clouds awaken and something comes out.
It is a wonderful thing to do my work. It is the greatest thing I have. And for my own sanity and my own satisfaction. And this is what comes out, and I guess I feel my desire and not the burden it really is.
Do you sometimes use your painting as part of your therapy?
No.
No, you don't use anything for therapy.
I don't know if I do. That is a great therapy, because I think that in general human beings have a desire to do the right thing for each of us. And artwork usually is part of this. And for artists, it is a very, very great part of existence. And if you do your work, you know you do the right thing. So when I work, I feel very good and very satisfied with my life. And if I don't work, I don't feel good. And I am very dissatisfied, and every morning I wake up with this feeling that something is amiss, and it's not right, and there is some trouble. And if I work, I wake up and I think, oh God, you know, this world is after all a very good place in which to be. So, that's the way.